The theme what I have chosen is an inspiration from the words of Jesus from Matthew Gospel, chapter 14, verse 27. Take courage, it is I, don't be afraid. Take courage, it is I, don't be afraid. In Telugu it says, Dhairyamu techukonidi nene bayapadakudani varito cheppaga. Dhairyamu techukondi nene bayapadakudani varito cheppaga. These are the words of assurance from Jesus Christ. Do not fear. Take courage. You know, we always have been haunted by fear. Some kind of fear. Fear is something very dangerous. Fear is something which will really make us lose our hope. Fear is something which always makes us to withdraw from the reality of life. Fear always makes us to take hasty decisions in our life. We try to run away. We try to hide. We try to isolate ourselves and including from the presence of God. When Jesus' disciples were traveling, whole night they were sitting in a boat. Imagine this context. And Jesus was with them whole day. And evening, Jesus alone goes onto the mountain. In this particular passage, chapter 14, verses 22 onwards, we see, వెంటనే జన సమూహములను తాను పంపివేయినంతలో తన శిష్యులు దోణి ఎక్కి తనకంటే ముందుగా అద్దరికి వెళ్ళవల్లని ఆయన వారిని బలవంతము చేసెను. ఆయన జన సమూహమును పంపివేసి ప్రార్థన చేయుటకు ఏకాంతముగా కొండ ఎక్కిపోయి సాయంకాలం అయినప్పుడు అక్కడ ఒంటిగా ఉండెను. అప్పటిక దోణి దరికి దూరమందుండగా గాలి ఎదురైనందున అలల వలన కొట్టబడుచుండెను. రాత్రి నాలుగవ జామున ఆయన సముద్రం మీద నడుచుచు వారి యొద్దకు వచ్చెను. లుక్ ఎట్ ద సినారియో అండ్ ద సిచ్యువేషన్. జీసస్ హస్ గాన్ టు ఎ సాలిటరీ ప్లేస్ టు ప్రే ఇన్ ద నైట్ అండ్ లుక్ ఎట్ ద టైమింగ్ ఇన్ విచ్ హీఈస్ అపియరింగ్ టు హిస్ డిసైపుల్స్ ఎర్లీ మార్నింగ్ దట్ ఈస్ అరౌండ్ 4 o'clock దట్ జీసస్ క్రైస్ట్ ఈస్ కమింగ్ అండ్ వాకింగ్ ఆన్ వాటర్. ద హోల్ నైట్ జీసస్ వాజ్ ఇన్ ప్రేయర్. Jesus' disciples know that Jesus is somewhere around them and is going to come back. But they did not expect that he is going to walk on the water. Walking on the water is an extraordinary feat, isn't it? We can swim, we can float, and we can dive and do so many gymnastics or the creativity, whatever we are equipped with in waters. But walking on water is not a possibility. But here, Jesus Christ has done a very unique thing to demonstrate to his disciples that he is in control of everything and he is above everything. In most of the ancient Near Eastern cultures and also in our Asian cultures, in dreams, if you get a dream about waters, we feel something is going bad is going to happen. Waters are always connected to some kind of fear, some kind of death or unusual news, or it is related to some kind of loss. So Jesus' disciple, one of the disciples, that is Peter, when he is questioning Jesus, his very questioning is like a provocative question. It is not a humble request. Lord, if it is really you, then let me come to you on water like you. Lord, if it is you, it is a kind of challenge that he is trying to pose to Jesus. Jesus says, you can come. And here we see that, you know, Jesus is being tested, like whether it is Jesus or not. Peter is joining like Satan. In Matthew Gospel chapter 4 verse 3 also, immediately after the baptism of Jesus, he was taken into wilderness. And there the tempter is asking a question, if you are the Son of God, in Matthew chapter 4, verse 3, and also in Matthew chapter 4, verse 6, this is how the Satan is questioning Jesus. If you are the Son of God, Here, Peter also is saying the same thing in the same tone, that Lord, if it is you, you make me to walk like you. And also we see the high priest in Matthew Gospel chapter 26, Matthew Suvartha 26 adhyayam, verse 63, 63 vachanam. Matthew 26 verse 63, there the high priest is telling Jesus, tell us if you are the Messiah, Son of God. Tell us if you are the Son of God. And the people near the cross in Matthew chapter 27 verse 40, Jesus has been mocked by so many people who are standing and watching what is happening to Jesus. And they were saying, come down from the cross if you are Son of God. Come down from the cross if you are Son of God. Jesus Christ, though he was challenged, though he was questioned, he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. No matter during the course of history of the church, there are so many heresies, so many challenges, but still the church continues to remain. The church faced so many tribulations, so many challenges. In spite of all that, we see that church continued to remain because Jesus is the head of the church. And Jesus's body is the church. And here we see that when Peter was asking, Jesus is giving him an opportunity. Come, you can do it. Peter initiated and he ventures out and he started to walk on the water. Some of the interpreters or the biblical scholars, what they say is, boat is considered as church, and Peter is trying to leave the church and coming out of the church, and he started to sink. No matter, you should be in the church and continue to walk with Jesus. You do not have to attempt to do any extraordinary things on your own. Peter may be trying to be like a hero to walk on the water compared to other 11 disciples. In our day-to-day life, when we are walking with Jesus, one is expected to remain in fellowship and continue to associate yourself and integrate yourself in the body of Jesus Christ. The winds may come, the storms may come, but Jesus is going to subdue everything and he is going to take in control of everything. Because in Matthew chapter 8, verses 23 to 27, there is another incident where Jesus was sleeping in the boat and Jesus' disciples were crying out for help. Jesus, Jesus, we are going to perish. And Jesus was able to control that and he is able to calm down the strong winds. He rebukes the wind and the sea. And now again, when Jesus has asked his disciple to walk on the water, then he was about to drown. Again, Jesus is extending his hand and restoring and is giving the assurance, do not be afraid. Don't be afraid. In our day-to-day faith journey, so many challenges comes to us. But in the midst of challenges, where do we stand in our relationship with God? Are we really fearing? Are we living with some kind of fear in our faith journey? What are the fears that we have? We need to make a list of the fears what we are passing through in our life and, you know, write down and place it in the Bible and pray. Lord, let me overcome these prayers. And then you tear off those papers, whatever you wrote, the fears what you are passing through. Whatever fears you are passing through today, you need to do one exercise. That is, write down on a white paper. What are the fears that is coming to you, or fear that is haunting you? And God is going to listen to your prayers and is going to wipe away every fear. We have one side, the fear of the world that some harm may come to us. And on the other hand, we have a fear of God, that if you do not obey God, if you don't listen to God, if you are not really obedient to God, God may punish us. That fear also is there. Sometimes when something goes wrong out of our hand, we immediately check, did I do something wrong against God? Is something wrong in between me, my relationship with God? am I really listening to God, or am I really pretending to in the presence of God that I am listening?
Okay.
You know, sometimes we are very good in pretending, isn't it? We can, you know, sometimes experiment with our own children. So we can experiment with our kids. We can experiment in our own family setup. We call, but children will say, yes, I'm listening, but there will not be any reaction. There will be a response, but there is no reaction. Likewise, God is calling us for various tasks. We are responding, but we are not reacting. Likewise, if you look into the life of Jonah, he's a very interesting personality. Jonah is mentioned in 2 Kings chapter 14, verse 25. He is a son of Amittai, the prophet from Gath Hefer, was asked to go to a big city. The city of his time is Nineveh. And the modern Nineveh is Mosul, Iraq. It was the great city of the Assyrian Empire. But when he was asked to go to that city and proclaim the gospel, he was very reluctant, because Assyrians were immediate enemies to the Israel nation. That conflict even goes on today also. That immediate enemies, when God is seeking compassion toward, God is showing compassion towards that enemy nation, he has chosen Prophet Jonah to go and proclaim gospel to them. He's been asked, he's been commissioned to go and prepare the people for repentance. But Jonah was very reluctant because they are enemies. He doesn't want to go to enemies and proclaim the gospel. We can see his intention in Jonah's prophetic book, that, you know, he was so sad and upset when God has forgiven that community. We can understand his heart, because he felt these enemies, because they are enemies, they should perish. Because they are against God's people, these people should receive the punishment. Because they are not in favor of Samaria or Israel or Jerusalem, these people should deserve all the outcome of a battle. That is what the prayer of Jonah was. But look at the heart of God. He has a great burden for everyone. People may be enemies to us, but they may be favorable to God. Our responsibility is to go and proclaim the gospel. Don't fear. It is God who is going to germinate the seed. Our responsibility is only like a sower who is be sowing the seed. It is God's work to grow the fruit in the kingdom of God. It is not you and me who will be growing. Jonah felt that, you know, by his going there, people would be transformed and people will receive favor. I don't want that to be happen. And that is the reason, instead of going to Nineveh, he is going to Tarshish. It is like the opposite direction. Nineveh is towards the east from Israel, and Tarshish is the opposite direction, towards the west, that is Spain. So instead of going to east, he travels towards west. He wants to go to Spain and enjoy his life. What a personality it is. Sometimes we can read our own life in the life story of Jonah. When we are asked to go to one place, when we are asked to go and see a family, when we are asked to go and talk to a person, we come to a conclusion and say that they don't deserve gospel. They deserve punishment. And Jonah might have had his own reservations or fear, because he has to go and preach to enemies. His life would be at stake. And out of that fear, he is trying to run away from God's word and God's commandment. When he's been asked to go to one place, he started to go to another place. But look at the heart of God, that he knows that Jonah is a capable person. He has the talent. Therefore, God has made a plan and decided that Jonah only should do this. Jonah has to go. when Jonah has taken a decision on his own, here we see that God is trying to teach him a lesson. He did not hand him over to death, but he asked a surprising big fish to come and swallow him. It is a very fascinating story to imagine. It is like traveling in an underground ship. It is very strange experience to go inside the fish and sit. I don't know what kind of smell will be there in the belly of fish. When you cut open itself, it is very horrible. When you handle with your hands, the smell doesn't go away that easily. Look at the situation in which Jonah is. Unbearable situation. There, he started to pray. When the trouble is around him, when he felt that he disobeyed God, when he felt that, you know, he is going the opposite direction, on his own direction and on his own decision, that is where he felt that he should turn to God and is praying. There is no other alternative there. He cannot jump out or he cannot cry. He cannot seek anyone's help. Even if he is maybe a great swimmer, the fish should allow him to come out. Now he is totally locked down in the belly of fish. That is where he began to pray. And he says that, you know, he is so convinced that, you know, God will hear my prayer and he will deliver me. This whole chapter 2 is a prayer made by Jonah. Let us look into three of those aspects of prayer. He is praying at a time of helplessness. We have a God when we approach him in helpless situation, or in a situation where we are disobeying to God, in a situation where we made our own decision which is wrong, but even in spite of that, God will not take vengeance on us, but he tries to listen to our prayer. For that matter, David in his lifetime, he has prayed on several occasions. In Psalms chapter 3 verse 4, Kirtanla Grandam 3 Adhyayam 4 Vachanam, in Psalms verse 3 and 4, he says, to the Lord I cry aloud, and he answers me from his holy hill. I lie down and sleep, I awake again, because the Lord sustains me. When did he pray? If you look at the title on the chapter 3, there it says, his own son Absalom was bringing a revolt and he made a plan to kill his father. Tana Sonta Kumaranetuvanti Absalomu Davidunu Champiveyalani Anukunnappudu దావీదు ఏం చేస్తున్నాడంటే దేవునికి అప్పజెప్తున్నారు తన కుటుంబ పరిస్థితులను బట్టి, మన కుటుంబంలో జరిగేటటువంటి పరిస్థితులను బట్టి. మన కుటుంబీకులతో మనము పోరాడకుండా మనము ఆత్మీయమైనటువంటి పోరాటము చేపట్టాలి. వి నీడ్ టు ఫైట్ ఎ స్పిరిచువల్ బ్యాటిల్ అండ్ వి నీడ్ టు బీ ఇన్ ద ప్రెజెన్స్ ఆఫ్ గాడ్. వెన్ ట్రబుల్స్ కమ్ ఇన్ అవర్ ఫ్యామిలీస్, ఇట్ ఈస్ నాట్ దట్ వి నీడ్ టు ఎంగేజ్ ఆర్సెల్స్ ఫైటింగ్ విత్ అవర్ చిల్డ్రన్ ఆర్ ఫైటింగ్ విత్ అవర్ సిస్టర్స్ అండ్ బ్రదర్స్, but we need to have a spiritual battle with the Lord in the presence of God. David should be our role model. He is a mighty warrior. He can go and get rid of his son. He loves his son so much. He doesn't want to take vengeance. That is true. That is a reality. We love our children, isn't it? Our parents loved us so much. No matter whatever decisions we made, no matter whatever dishonorable things we have done, no matter whatever decisions we have made against the wishes of our parents, against the heritage of our family, the culture of family, but still they love us. Likewise, David also has a great love towards his own son, Absalom. That is where when his son is bringing a revolt against him, that is where he says, Lord, I cry out aloud, and you are going to answer me from your holy hill, Mount Zion. Because your presence is there, your tabernacle is there. You are going to answer and send answer from there. And again in Psalms 18, Kirtanla Grandam 18th Adhyayam 6th Vachanam, Psalms 18 verse 6. In my distress I called to the Lord. I cried to my God for help. From his temple he heard my voice. My cry came before him into his ears. నా దుఃఖము దేవుని సమక్షంలో దేవుని చెవుల్లో వినిపించబడింది అంటున్నాడు. He cried in such a way God has heard his prayer. When did he write this psalm? When he got victory from King Saul. When Saul was about to kill, God has redeemed David. Again here, his own family. Saul is not an outsider for David. His own father-in-law. My dear brothers and sisters, when our families are against us, look to God. When our families are not listening to us, look to God. When our families are not obeying us, you pray to God. You need to spend time in the presence of God. Intercede. David was crying. And he says, Lord has heard my voice when I cried to God. What is the need for a king to cry? Sarvasadharananga magavalanu edse magavalanu nammad antaru kadandi. Davidu edustu devuni samakshamlo prarthistu unnadu. Emani ante prabhuva idigo na kutumbanni nannu rakshinchu. Na santa mamane nannu tarmuchu unnadu. నన్ను విడిపించు అని దేవుని సన్నిధానంలో గోజాడుచు ఉన్నాడు. దేవుని పరిశుద్ధ పర్వతం నుంచి నాకు సహాయం వచ్చును అని గొప్ప నిరీక్షణతో దావీదు నడుచుకుంటూ ఉన్నాడు. ప్రేమైనటువంటి దేవుని బిడ్డలారా, మన జీవితంలో వచ్చే కష్టాల్లో మనము చేపట్టినటువంటి నిర్ణయాలను బట్టి ఒకవేళ దేవునికి దూరంగా జీవించినా, ఇదిగో దేవుడు మన ప్రార్థన విజ్ఞాపన వింటాడు. యోనా జీవితంలో దేవునికి విరోధంగా ఆయన ప్రయాణం చేస్తూ ఉన్నప్పుడు, దేవుడు కరుణించి ఆయనను బంధించినప్పుడు దేవుని వైపు చూస్తూ ఉన్నాడు. దేవుడు నా మొర వింటాడు, దేవుడు నన్ను కాపాడుతాడు అనే గొప్ప విశ్వాసం ఇక్కడ యోనాకు కలిగింది. అటువంటి విశ్వాసం మనకు కలగాలి. ఎందుకంటే ఇదిగో భయపడకుము, ధైర్యము తెచ్చుకొనుము, నేనే ప్రభు మనల్ని దర్శిస్తూ ఉన్నాడు. గాడ్ ఈస్ విజిటింగ్ అస్. He is coming to us. He is not asking us to walk somewhere else now. Week after week, God is giving us that opportunity to gather in His name, and Jesus is coming to us. We are in our own boats with safety, but Jesus is walking over water and coming to us. Every Sunday, He is coming and knocking our doors. And when we cry to Him, He is going to answer our prayers. Therefore, let us be courageous. The second thing is that, you know, Jonah is remembering the temple of the Lord. He is remembering the temple of the Lord when he is about to die, where he felt that, you know, his life is going to conclude in the belly of this fish. If something swallows us, will there be any assurance of life? But here Jonah was looking to God. And he says, you know, when I look and when I pray to you, you are going to extend your help from your temple, holy temple. I have been banished from your sight. Here he is remembering that, you know, Lord, I am banished from your presence. I am not able to come into your sight. Sannidhilo nundi velivaya badinanu ani antunadu. దేవుని సన్నిధిలో నుంచి వెలివేయబడినప్పటికీ దేవుడు నీ యొక్క ప్రార్థన వింటాడు. నీ పరిశుద్ధ ఆలయం తట్టు మరలా చూచేదానని అనుకుంటున్నాను అంటున్నాడు. దేవుని సన్నిధానము దొరికినప్పుడు ఆయన వాడుకున్నాడో లేదో తెలియదు, కానీ దేవుని సన్నిధి దొరకనప్పుడు, అయ్యో దేవుని సన్నిధి కావాలి నాకు, దేవుని సహవాసం కావాలని ఇక్కడ మొరపెడుతూ ఉన్నాడు. ఇప్పుడు మన సమయాల్లో కూడా, ఇప్పుడు ఈ పాండమిక్ టైంలో అనుకుంటున్నాం కదా, చర్చి ధరిస్తే బాగుండేది అని. చర్చి ఉంటే బాగుండేది. వేరు వేరు రీజన్స్, ప్రార్థన చేసుకోవాలని కొందరు, ఎంటర్టైన్మెంట్ కొరకు కొందరు, కనీసం గుడియారు పోతానన్నా కొంచెం ఎంటర్టైన్మెంట్ అవుతుంది కదా అని కొందరు, ఎన్నో ఆలోచనలు. దేవుని సన్నిధానంలో ప్రార్థించే భాగ్యం మనకు దొరుకుతుందని కొందరు, దేవుని సన్నిధానంలో ప్రార్థిస్తే దేవుడు నా ప్రార్థన వింటాడు అనే నమ్మకం కొందరికి. ప్రపంచమంతా కూడా ఈ సందేహాలతో వారి జీవితాల్లో ఉన్నారు. ఆల్ వరల్డ్, ఆల్ ద క్రిస్టియన్ కమ్యూనిటీస్ ఆర్ లుకింగ్ టువర్డ్స్ గాడ్. లార్డ్ గివ్ us another opportunity where we can come to your sanctuary. Jonah is remembering when in an unusual situation where he is binded, there is no possibility of coming out. And that is where he says, Lord, you have banished me from your presence. I thought I am going to come into your sanctuary. But the community of Israel who are in the northern region after King Solomon, when the kingdom is divided into two, for the northern region, Samaria was the temple. And for the Judah region, Jerusalem was the temple. For Samaritans, that was their own holy sanctuary. Jonah comes from the northern region after Jeroboam II. During the time of Jeroboam II, the descendant of Jeroboam, who was the commander of Israel and later who becomes the first king of the northern kingdom. And this Jeroboam II is one of the descendants of that Jeroboam. And this Jeroboam's time, Jonah was prophesizing. And Jonah, when he took his own decision, he was feeling that, you know, Lord, you have banished me from your holy temple. I thought I am going to go back to the temple after spending some time in Spain or in Tarshish. I am going to come back. But now, oh Lord, that hope is gone. He felt that, you know, waters are really threatening him. He is in an engulfing waters that he cannot come out. He is at that ebb of his own life. He thought that is the last moments of his life. He is going to die. That is where he is remembering the presence of God. He is remembering the holy temple. And he says, Lord, you know, I want to see again. Yet again, I will look again toward your holy temple. I want to look towards your holy temple. During the Jerusalem temple's dedication, if you remember King Solomon's prayer in 1 Kings chapter 8, Prabhuva evaraina ni mandiram tattu tama chetuletti prarthinchinappudu neevu vaari prarthana vintavu. Lord, whoever raises their hand and look towards your temple, when they pray, you are going to listen to their prayers. Our God is a God. Even if you are far away in a distant place, when you turn towards his temple and pray, you are going to answer those prayers. That was the conviction of the Israel community. That is the reason Daniel was praying, keeping his window open towards the temple of Jerusalem. In whatever the direction it may be, he was keeping his windows open towards Jerusalem temple and he was praying. That was their understanding. That was their conviction, that when we look towards God's temple and raise our hands and pray, God is going to answer our prayers. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, in an unusual situation, when we remember God's presence, he is going to respond. He is going to react. He is going to send out help. And the third thing what we see here in this prayer of Jonah in Jonah chapter 2 verses 1 to 10. Verse 9 we come across, he says, I with a song of thanksgiving will sacrifice to you. What I have vowed I will make good. Salvation comes from the Lord. He is trying to repent in the presence of God, saying in his prayer, he's saying that I, with a song of thanksgiving, I will sacrifice. He's not saying that I am going to sacrifice a lamb. He's not saying that I am going to sacrifice 1,000 bulls. He's not saying that I am going to bring all the precious things into your presence. He's saying, Lord, with a song of thanksgiving, I am going to come into your presence. God needs our sacrifices. God is looking at a repentant heart. God is looking at a repentant lips. You need to come back to God as you are with a song of thanksgiving. Nothing else. You do not have to do anything extraordinary. Just as you are, you need to come into the presence of God. Here Jonah is repenting, saying, Lord, I am going to come back to your presence with a song of thanksgiving. I am going to sacrifice to you. He is not saying that, I am going to do this, Lord, I am going to do that. But he's saying that, you know, wholeheartedly. When does a song come out from our mouth? When we are in a joyous situation, isn't it? Wholeheartedly we sing, no matter whatever the tune may be. But still, you know, we try to sing to express our joy, which is coming from our heart. If we are not singing also, at least we'll try to respond to the rhythm. We'll try to make hum something, you know, when we are expressing our joy from the heart. Here, Jonah is expressing that same tone. Wholeheartedly, I am going to come and sing to you. That is what it meaning. And in Psalms 50, verse 14, sacrifice thank offerings to God, fulfill your vows to the Most High, and call upon me in the days of trouble. I will deliver you, and you will honor me. This is the assurance that we have from God. Here David is saying that, you know, you need to call upon God in the days of trouble. He is going to deliver you. He is going to honor you. No matter whatever trouble we may be passing through. No matter whatever difficult phase of life we are in. Here we have a God. When we look to Him, He is going to answer our prayer. He is going to honor us, provided you need to sacrifice your life with thanksgiving. Wholeheartedly, you need to pour yourself in the presence of God. Wholeheartedly, you need to come and joyfully sing the song of thanksgiving. And further, we see in Hosea chapter 14, Hosea Grandam Patnalu Adjayam Randavachanam. Prophet was told that, take words with you and return to the Lord. Say to Him, forgive all our sins and receive us graciously, that we may offer the fruit of our lips. God is looking at the repentant heart. He is seeking you and me to turn at once. He is not going to banish us forever. He is not going to accuse us forever. But He is inviting us back. No matter whatever difficult situation you may be, if you feel that this is the end, no, that is not the end. There is some new beginning is going to happen in your life. There is something, if one door is closed, God is going to open several doors for you. If one road is ending, God is going to make another way for you. Here, Hosea prophet is saying that, you know, I'll call upon me, and I'm going to call, turn to the Lord. He is going to forgive and wipe away all the sins and receive me back graciously. And I will offer the fruit of my lips. David is saying with the heart. Jonah is saying with the heart. Again, here Hosea is saying, even talking is very important. Even my lips are going to seek forgiveness and offer the fruit of my lips. In Hebrews chapter 13, Hebrew Grandam, 13th Adhyayam, 15th Vachanam, Hebrews chapter 13, verse 15. Through Jesus, therefore, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that confess His name. Jesus is seeking our heart. We need to confess His name, that in His name there is salvation. In His name there is restoration. In His name there is new life and new creation. Hebrew writer is reminding the early church community who are persecuted, who are hunted to death, who are separated from their families, who are humiliated in the society because they were confessing Jesus' name. And he says, you know, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise. A time will come when you are going to worship me in worship, in spirit and in truth. ఒక సమయం వచ్చును అంటున్నారు సమరయ స్త్రీతో యేసుక్రీస్తు ప్రభు. ఆ సమయం ఏంటంటే నిన్ను పరలోకపు తండ్రిని ఆత్మతోను సత్యముతోను ఆరాధించేటటువంటి సమయం. అది దేవాలయంలో కాదు, యెరూషలేము మందిరంలో కాదు, సమరయ కొండ పైన కాదు, ఆత్మతోను సత్యంతోను ఆరాధించే సమయం మన జీవిత కాలంలో సంభవించింది. ఇన్ అవర్ టైమ్ ద టైమ్ హస్ కమ్ టు వర్షిప్ హిమ్ ఇన్ స్పిరిట్ అండ్ ఇన్ ట్రూత్. ఆర్ యు రన్నింగ్ అవే లైక్ జోనా? Are you giving any excuse or trying to justify like Jonah that they are enemies? I don't want to go there. They deserve the punishment. I don't want to listen to God. I want to make my own choices. When your choices are wrong, you know, God is going to pause you. When we are in paused situation, we need to really examine ourselves. Lord, what is that you want me to do? Am I really doing what you are expecting me to do? What is the purpose of my life, Lord? God has a great plan and purpose in each one of our life. When we do not have a job, we really dedicated ourselves to God, saying, Lord, you give me a job. Lord, you open a way for me. Definitely, I am going to seek and serve you. Did we fail to seek and serve the Lord when we got a job? When we pass certain exams, you know, we pray to God before exam, saying, Lord, give me wisdom so that my wisdom would be used for your honor. I am going to dedicate myself to you, Lord, with this wisdom. I am going to seek and serve you, Lord. Did you fail? Did you fail to keep up the word, to seek and serve the Lord with your wisdom, what God has given you? Whenever there was a need of a promotion, we pray to God saying, Lord, you give me this promotion. Then after this, I'm going to do your service. After this, I'm going to do like this. We made so many vows to God. Every visa renewal time, we pray to God, Lord, give me one more chance. Lord, give me another opportunity. Take away every hurdle, Lord, so that I will continuously engage myself to seek and serve you. God has been answering our prayers, even though we are not doing his work. Even though we did not keep up our vows, God is really blessing us. Lord, settle me down in a family life. Definitely, as a family, I am going to worship you. Then after the family life coming, we have our own excuses to God. Lord, you know, I am so busy with my husband, with my wife. I am so busy with my children, Lord. I am so busy with my children's school, Lord. Busy, busy, busy. This has become a very most used word in our day-to-day conversations. Busy. How is life? Oh, busy. We are so busy. We don't have time to God also. We are unable to even keep up appointments what we give to God sometimes. We give time to God. We give appointments to God. But we fail to keep up our appointments with God. We try to fulfill all the other appointments. The priority is other appointments. Whether it may be about our job, whether it may be about our interviews, whether it may be about our family, whether it may be about our friends, whether it may be about our pleasure, we have time for them. We have a lot of priorities to those things. When it comes to God's work, when it comes to God's kingdom, when it comes to seek God, you know how to seek excuse in the presence of God. With a very sad tone, we come and say, Lord, you know my situation. Lord, you know what difficulty I have. Please excuse me. He has been excusing us for several years. No matter, we may be running away, but as and when he is putting brakes here and there, as and when he is asking us to pause, you know, we need to pray to God like Jonah. Because our God is a God who listens to our prayer when we are in helpless situation. He remembers us when we pray and look towards his fellowship. When we truly repent with our wholeheartedness, he is going to answer our prayer. And further he says, what I have vowed, I will make good. Here Jonah is saying, Lord, whatever vow I have made, I am going to fulfill now. He is repenting that I am going to come back with thanksgiving song. And secondly, he says, I am going to fulfill the vow what I have made. David also says in Psalm 54:14, fulfill your vows to the Most High. Fulfill your vows. And in Ecclesiastes chapter 5, verse 4 and 5, Prasangi Grandam, Aidava Ajayam, Nalgo Aidava Vachanam. When you make a vow to God, do not delay in fulfilling it. He has no pleasure in fools. Fulfill your vow. It is better not to vow than to make a vow and not fulfill it. When you are making a vow, you need to fulfill it. The vows are not given by God, my dear brothers and sisters. It is we who have vowed to God. Lord, you know, give me this. I am going to do that. I am going to serve you, Lord. Lord, use me as your instrument. But when opportunity is given, we want to step back. మనము మ్రొక్కి మ్రొక్కుబడి ఏదైనా ఉన్నట్లయితే అది చెల్లించడానికి ఆతృత పడాలి. నీవు మ్రొక్కుబడి చెల్లించని ఎడల దాన్ని తొందరగా ముగించుము అని ప్రసంగి గ్రంథంలో జ్ఞాపకం చేయబడుతున్నాం. ఎన్నో మ్రొక్కుబడులు మ్రొక్కాం. ప్రభువా నాకు కుమార్తె నువ్వు, ప్రభువా నాకు కుమారుని నువ్వు, నీ కొరకే నేను పెంచుతానని చెప్తాం. God has given us kids. To whom are we raising them? Lord, give me a job so that I would be resourceful for your kingdom. Where are our resources going? Are we honoring God with our resources? Lord, give me this wisdom, give me this talent so that I would serve you. Is your talent honorable to God? Are you really honoring God with your talent? What measure of time are you giving? What measure of conversation are you having with God? What measure of your heart is with God? What is the percentage that you are spending your lifetime or your heart with God? My dear brothers and sisters, no matter whatever troubled you are, God is coming to you. God is knocking your heart. Take courage. It is Jesus. Don't be afraid. Don't live with fear. Don't withdraw yourself from the community. Don't withdraw from your family. Don't withdraw from the fellowship of God. God is coming to you. We all do mistakes. We all make wrong choices. We all do wrong directions. But we have a God who is coming after us, who is going to lift us up. As how he gave his hand to Peter, saying that, you of little faith, come back. Stand firm. He was restored. Likewise, our Jesus is always coming to us to restore us, to strengthen us, so that we would be walking with him. We would be always with him. He has gone ahead of us to prepare a place for us and is going to come back and take us there. What is our preparation today? What is our faith journey today? Shall we bow our heads and pause for a moment in silence, examining ourselves? What are the choices that we are making? What is the direction that we are walking? Is it from God or is it on our own? If God is pausing you, if situation is unfavorable, look to God. Don't run away. Ask God, seek God's help. God is going to help you. People have limitations to help us or help you and me. But God is there everywhere. He's going to help us.